Tragedy. inside. Somebody claims to see the light. It seems to me that all of us have lost our patience. 'Cause everyone thinks they're right, and nobody thinks that there just might be more than one road to our final destination. But I'm not. Time I spent a waste. 'Cause so many choices point the same way.
Gaming Bets. We accept bets on computer games online since 2011. Referral system for regular users and the first deposit bonus. Gaming devices store and the best choice of payment systems. Dota 2 and Hearthstone, Counter-Strike and StarCraft, World of Tanks and League of Legends. EGB.com. You know for sure who's going to win.
G2A.com, the best video game store ever! Fast as lightning! Solid as a rock! Cheap as duck! What's more, you can sell on it because it's also a marketplace! Remember G2A.com, the best video game store ever!
Welcome Counter-Strike fans from across the globe, I'm Jim Inesso and welcome to the second season of Counterpit. Joining me on this evening's panel is none other than PK Noodle and PDG. How are we going this morning or this afternoon, gents?
Wonderful. I'm so happy to be here. I mean, it's such a privilege and an honour to be casting American Counterpeed. And we got the call up quite late, but I'm loving it here and looking forward to some great games of Counter-Strike.
How are you feeling, Pete?
Yeah, doing pretty well. I think we're going to have to stop telling people to give us a break for not knowing the North American scene at some point, because we seem to be casting all these NA Counterpeed games, which is obviously sweet for us. We love doing it. We love getting involved and, you know, saying g'day, mate, to NA counterparts across the globe.
It's important though to clarify. I mean, you say all the NA Counterpeed games so far. I mean, I think we've casted two so far. But importantly, though, the slate will soon be wiped afresh. I mean, they've gone through some structural changes. So there are essentially now five teams. They've changed the format. So there are five teams: SKDC, Splice, Enemy Method, and Winterfox. And all previous matches and scores have been wiped clean. So this is essentially the first game of the season.
And what a fantastic first game of the season it is as well. We do have Splice up against Enemy. So two teams that actually played off against each other quite recently.
Yeah, they did face off against each other in what I believe to be the final of the MLG American Miners, in which Enemy GG came out 16-7, 16-9 on top on Keish and Inferno. So the edge going to Enemy GG in that matchup, but the story, of course, from that event was the performance of Kusta, the star AWPer for Enemy GG, and his 2.03 rating and plus 37, which was just an absolutely unheard of performance.
No, it was incredible, wasn't it? I mean, you had people making VODs about that performance straight afterwards. You had all the big names giving him a lot of credit and a lot of attention, and certainly well-deserved. It was incredible play by him. I think a lot of people are probably tuning in today just to see how well he can back it up. This is the first game in which he will be playing and Enemy will be playing since that performance in the grand final that you speak of. So I think there'll be a lot of hype associated with how well he'll do today, and really looking forward to it. On the Splice side, I mean, these guys themselves, I mean, we said they're coming off a loss in that grand final, but they have had some good results themselves recently. I mean, they did take down, I do believe it was Optic, to even make that grand final. Now, that's a massive win for these guys. Certainly, they were the underdogs in that semi-final against a team such as Optic with that backing and support, and certainly high expectations that have been placed upon them. So the fact that they even made that sort of situation speaks really wonders to how well the team's progressing at the moment.
Yeah, absolutely, mate. And the thing to notice about Splice, my apologies, that's the first time I mixed those words up today, but the Splice roster actually were able to secure an overtime win against Optic on Cobble. Now, usually when you see these sorts of teams upset a bigger team like Optic, it's a case where Optic just didn't show up at all and they got blown off the map twice. You see that regularly where a heavily favorited team just doesn't give the level of energy required to sort of get them through. There you can see Optic really turned up to play, getting all the way to overtime, and Splice just edged them out there, taking the map on Cobble and then losing on Keish, but interesting enough, winning on Mirage in the third map. So it showed there that Optic was playing decent CS in overtime, and also a win on Keish, and Splice were able to just come up with the goods on that day. So you can't necessarily just write off that one good performance they've had.
Most definitely. I mean, it's important, given that we're saying this is now the first match of the American Counterpeed season in its new form, to set the context as well, because there's so much that they're playing for right now. I mean, the winner, of course, of this five-team group will have the opportunity to go to Croatia to compete in the LAN finals in March of this year. I mean, there's an $80,000 prize purse there. We already know that there are some world-class teams that have confirmed their attendance. So we've got Virtus Pro, we've got Na'Vi, Envy Us. Of course, we have the Australian qualifier winners in the form of Immunity as well, and they're certainly not one to count out as a quality opposition on any day of the week. So there's so much on the line here. These are teams that perhaps wouldn't ordinarily have that opportunity to compete against the world's best teams that we're speaking of, and you can be guaranteed that they'll all be so hungry to really come out firing now. It is a best of two format. Every single map counts in such a tight cutthroat format such as this. So no doubt they'll be wanting to give their all from the get-go.
I said, I think if we need to emphasize anything, it's that the best of two format essentially places a premium on winning. So to get the maximum amount of points from any sort of tie, you really need to make sure that you're winning across two maps, and a really strong performance is what really counts in this instance. So that being said, from your perspectives on each of this team and knowing what you know now and looking at their histories, Nick, I'm going to throw this one to you, or PK for those in the audience. I guess, who would be your pick, and who would be the players to watch?
Well, I think it's hard to look past Enemy, given the pure fact alone that these two teams played each other only about a week and a half ago, and Enemy came out quite decisively. I think they've got the track record there. Whilst we will see them playing different maps tonight in the form of Mirage and Terrain, two maps in which they did not play each other on at the MLG American Minor Championship, I think that the form and the confidence which they'll be bringing into this match should get them across the line 2-0, in my opinion. I'd love to say Kooster is the player to watch. I think that's obviously the easy pick. That goes without saying. But if there was a second person, which might be more interesting, if there was a second person in which I'd be looking to, it would be Mainline. Now, of course, he is the in-game leader of the team, previously played on Method, alongside Justin and I think Anomaly and a few of those sort of guys. But for me, it's very important as the in-game leader when you do have a star player such as Kooster in terms of how you are using them in the context of the match. We know from previous interviews and whatnot and having the opportunity to watch Mainline and his teams that they are quite a structured team, and perhaps the words one-dimensional might be appropriate in that instance. Everyone has their set roles and a very structured and guided approach to the rounds, but when you've got an explosive player, it's an interesting balance trying to put them in positions to succeed whilst making sure everyone else is doing their jobs properly. So I think there's a lot on Mainline's shoulders to help put Kooster and his teammates in the right positions.
Yep, Pete, and then I'll throw the same thing to you. I think you're a little bit more open about who you think might win.
Yeah, so I think Enemy GG has the nod on the first map. But I'm really interested to see what Splice has on their second map, which is, I think it was their Train pick. I think that they picked that second map on Train. And what's interesting about these selections is Splice actually beat Optic on Mirage. So this is a very awkward matchup for me, because whilst Kooster could go off with that AWP and easily shut down this match, I think that if you're Enemy and you're picking that map, you clearly feel like a superior team on it. But, you know, Splice aren't going to have nothing on this map, so it could be interesting, but definitely Enemy for the first map. The second map, for me, the player to watch on this team will be Professor Chaos on T-side. He's a player who's known for getting some pretty insane frags due to his massively high sensitivity. And on a map like Train, where you legitimately can just smoke up the entire bombsite or train yard and turn the whole thing into a lottery of who sees who first, I think having that high sensitivity and that short reaction time may benefit them a lot. So it'll be interesting to see how that match unfolds, but I'm actually backing a 1-1 here. I think Enemy will take number one and Splice will take them out on Train.
Some fantastic insight into that, and I think it must be noted, of course, if anyone was wondering, we of course are actually Australian casters. Not native to North America, but nonetheless certainly able to bring a premium production nonetheless. So, yeah, if anyone was wondering, of course, I'm Jimmy Nesso. You can follow me on Twitter at DeepJimPact. You can follow PK at PKNoodle on Twitter. And, of course, PDG on Twitter at IMPDG. So stay tuned. I think we may be possibly bringing you more North American counter pit action, nonetheless. But the first map, Mirage, maybe
yes.
Give us your thoughts on that particular pick for Enemy.
It's a very scary prospect, I think, for Splice, because it's certainly a map that has a lot of different AWP angles open to it. I mean, most commonly, of course, you can see AWP as most... in most situations in the mid window, but I mean, you can AWP B, you can push the A palace and lock that down, you can play towards the ticker box. There's a lot of different angles in which you can see AWPers play, so I think the prospect of coming up against Kooster could be very, very scary for a team such as Splice. I'm not also sure as well. I mean, I know Splice have had some difficulties in recent times trying to find a core five with the team. I mean, they've gone through players such as Kiko, Mo, they trolled out Davey at one point, now he's back in the team. I'm not quite sure how well their teamwork and cohesion is going to be, and certainly a map like T-side Mirage, in which there's a lot of set smokes, a lot of structure normally getting brought into things, I'm not sure how well they're going to be prepared to be able to use those smokes effectively to lock out and block the vision of Kooster and to really isolate him from sites like you'd need to be.
Yeah, in saying that though, I do think that Splice are going through that generic... that generic situation that a lot of teams, no matter what level of CS you're at, can relate to, where just nothing really seems to click with your roster, and no matter how hard you try to make the roster you have work. Ultimately, there are limitations to what you can do because of your personnel. And it's definitely one of those situations where Splice have had to piece things together. But luckily, you don't have to listen to our Aussie twang for too much longer trying to get all the information across, because I believe all 10 players are just about in the server.
Well, yeah, I thought they were going live into the knife round, and then my map just changed. So I hope that it's not just me. You're seeing the same as well yourself?
Yeah, I think they actually might be restarting the server. So.
Okay. But it's interesting for me, because certainly coming into this match and really for the last few months, the tagline that a lot of people had been throwing around when you talked about Enemy was that they'd been long billed as this up-and-coming team in North America who really were reliant on their star player in the form of Kuster. But there's only so long you can keep calling them up-and-coming when they're now starting to win tournaments and to get a lot of attention. I think that tag certainly is being erased a little bit competition by competition.
Yeah, and for me, this draws straight back to the age-old argument of results versus potential. You know, potential is this unquantifiable mass that someone has inside them that either can be realized or can't be realized, or, you know, someone gets a little bit into their potential and drops off because their attitude changes, or they max out their potential and they turn into star players. It's a really sort of unknown quantity, the whole potential thing. And I think that at this point, Enemy are starting to realize their potential, and it's up to them. Now we can really see if they actually have the potential with this roster to go forward, because now all the pieces are in place. Kooster's really starting to pick it up. They have a starish player to build around. Don't want to overhype the guy because he's still, you know, moving into sort of the bright end of his career. You don't want to build him up so high that he seems like he could go overseas and battle with the likes of Kenny S and Guardian. So certainly in that respect, you don't want to overhype him. But for this team, he certainly plays a similar role to those players. So in that sense, he does match up, will match up against those players. And for me, it'll be the same. You know, can Enemy actually get past this little phase of their team's life without having to make a roster change?
It's interesting for me as well when you compare who Kooster will be matching up against. Of course, the AWPA, as we understand it, we are Australian, of course, but the AWPA, as we understand on Splice, will be Aria. Now, Aria is also the team captain, the IGL. He has a lot riding on his shoulders. Now, I mean, if it wasn't enough to be having to worry about the fact that you've got this star AWPA on the other side, that's a lot of responsibility to be really putting on the back of your shoulders on your team. I'm just trying to wonder how much of an impact that's going to have on his gameplay. It's an interesting thought for me.
Yeah, and it's very, very rare, I guess, that you see a top-tier in-game leader who's also a top-tier AWPer in CSGO, because of the importance and onus that's placed on the AWP player to really produce with that weapon, given the cost of the rifle and the reward for kills and how much keeping those snipers in play will affect, you know, how each round goes. So as an IGL, it's very hard to put an AWPer, which is yourself, in a very aggressive situation, because then if you die, your team's without your in-game leader. So often you see that the in-game leader AWPers are the more defensive AWPers because they stay alive for longer and get more out of the round. But I don't necessarily think that's the best option in CSGO, where aggressive AWPing and being proactive really rewards your team. So it'll be interesting to see if he's going to continue AWPing, if he's also going to be the in-game leader moving forward. But for today, he has his work cut out for him, trying to outthink the caller on NVGG, and also out AWP Kooster. That's going to be a big challenge.
Another big challenge, I think, for yourself, Pete, will be the fact that most, if not all, I can see on the Splice team, their players are actually tagged up with special aliases tonight, not necessarily their real names. And I think yourself are going to be having a little bit of a mouthful there to try and do the conversions in your head before you say them out. Of course, the lineup for Splice is Aria, Jason R, A, Professor Chaos, and Davey. But you only find about Davey and Aria tagged up as such, Pete. So good luck with all that, and Godspeed.
Well, I'll figure out Professor Chaos pretty easily, P_C. I think you'll probably find me referring to Jason R as Junior Nasty, as he was tagged up in the last cast that we had. Vintage JR Nasty. And A1 will probably just call A1, because that's the way it's going to come out of my mouth. On the other side of things, Uber, Relics, Chocolate, I'm guessing, is Kooster.
I hope so.
I'm guessing that to be the case. And I think this looks like knife round?
Yes, just the knife round.
It's going to be the knife round here. So we'll see who comes out on top here. We're not even sure which side either of these teams prefer at this point. So the knife round for us is a bit unconsequential from our perspective, but certainly for the teams themselves, it means a lot to get their choice of sides, but obviously Mirage not being that dependent on having a good CT or T half, one of the more balanced maps in CSGO. So Splice coming away with the knife, and it looks as though they are going to stay on the CT side of things.
Yes, we will see them starting on the CT side. It's important for these guys. I mean, we did see, even though the match technically hasn't counted now as a counterfeit game, given that the slate has been wiped back to zero, we did have the privilege of casting these guys earlier on against Winterfox, and we saw on one of the matches CT side actually start out quite strongly on CT Mirage against Winterfox, if I'm not mistaken, in that instance. So it's definitely a map in which once they get a roll on, they can be quite a menacing team to be coming up against. So it's important for Enemy, I think, this new up-and-coming team, I'll stop saying that after this, to really get on a roll early, Pete.
Yeah, and as we move into the pistol round, obviously Enemy favours this A-bomb site almost immediately as they line themselves up for cheeky little A-hit here. Four players moving into the A-halls part of things with just that one player MNL with that smoke grenade that's probably going to come over the roof. Here it comes. So the smokes and flashes will run in, just the stairs smoked off. The CT player there gets a spot off, but Professor Chaos not calling anything, so this is an interesting tactic here. They've only thrown one smoke and a flash, now they're going to allow the enemy, the spicy deer players, to think it's fake, but it's not going to be. Uber rains out a carpet there, getting A1 instantly down, and now it's all going to be on Splice UG to make their way back into the bomb site, and Professor Chaos opens it up pretty well there.
That's right, we're down to a 3-on-4 situation, so all to do for Enemy at this stage, but lucky in their pushing city, Spawny does a fantastic job. Gets those two frags, and I think actually one of the members of Splice might have actually just timed out or left the server, which is really unfortunate when you have a man advantage in that sort of situation to be on the receiving end of a technical issue. But in any case, fantastic job from Enemy. Can't help but feel they would have won that round anyway, given some of those big frags they got. But to me, Pete, a really questionable T-side pistol strategy there. Poor old mainline MNL, as you referred to him, really sacrificed himself for the greater good. It caused that rotation from Splice. They actually had four members on that A-bomb site as he ran into the site. But given the 5 or so seconds that they delayed in terms of executing after his death, Splice did run away. But really, the cost of a man there, I'm not sure if that would work out if you repeated that in some sort of imaginary CSGO simulator time and time again.
Yeah, definitely a bit of a risk there taken by Enemy GG, but also we see the mindset of that team is going to be pretty aggressive for this entire map, as other than, of course, this Antica round, which they're happy to just sit back and use those rifles, and they've just got the two SMGs. So Uber's going to make his way up the A ramp there onto A1 with a nice little headshot, and Chocolate, which I believe is Kusta, he's going to pick one up as well. So it's just a really easy Antica unfollowing here for Splice at the moment.
Yeah, that's right. You could see that Splice had invested in a couple of pistols, some light armor as well. So trying to do that sort of damage to the players of Enemy, but struggling a little bit there in the end that they did get one frag there. Good work by Davey. But that's probably going to do it, I think, at this point. The bomb will go down now, and it's pretty pedestrian from here on out, as there's just one surviving member, and the time is now ticking until the round explodes.
Yeah, and something we definitely talk about a lot when we cast Australian action, and you see two potentially teams that don't match up very well. So it's certainly in this favor, Enemy GG has the advantage here in previous matchups, and also I guess star power and that stability of roster. So all signs lead towards Enemy GG, and when that happens, I think that that allows you a certain amount of freedom and arrogance as a player, and the Enemy roster are going to try and bully Splice out of a lot of their positions on their T side. They're going to get in there nice and early, get that entry pick, and try and force those incorrect rotations from Splice. And it's up to them to hold onto those sites, use that individual skill, and make some good reads as Davey gets a cheeky little P250 frag onto the head of Relics.
Yeah, cheeky was my word of choice as well. You stole that out of my mouth there, but it was. And in the end, he did get a nice double for the round, so that'll slightly help his economy. You can see that at the moment, they're around that 3K sort of mark. I think with Professor Chaos, I think he might have perhaps fully saved on that round, just building up that economy, because he has $4,000, which is quite balling at this stage of the match. But the rest of his teammates definitely will find themselves in an eco round. And really, their mindset will certainly be looking towards this first gun round. There'll be only so much they can do. You can see that they have invested in some light P250s here, but it looks as though the guys have just paused the server. They're just fine-tuning some of the settings, I think, on the server at the moment, so it should be underway in a second.
Yeah, and also, Professor Chaos definitely echoing there, not particularly interested in that extra pistol. He's going to either AWP himself, or he's going to definitely drop that AWP for Arya. I'm pretty sure he's going to... Arya? Arya? Are you going to make a difference, are you?
Leave that alone, mate. That's horrible.
We pronounce things differently. I say Arya, you say Arya. Tomato, tomato, potato, potato.
Yeah, one of us is right, one of us is wrong. But in any case, right, it will be interesting to see as we move into this first round. I'm happy, though, that if there had to be a pause to come in to at least get some of these teething issues sorted, it's happening now during what is really an eco round here for Splice. I think that if it was during the gun rounds in the middle of the match, it might be quite disruptive for the players. But I think now that really, I think it will be a one-sided round as we move on to this anti-eco, or at least it should be. We all know how well CSGO can go sometimes with the strength of pistols, but I think this is a good time. I don't think the players will mind too much.
No, definitely not. It'll give the Splice guys just an opportunity to really talk about what they're going to do next round. Obviously, nothing heavy invested in this round at all. So it's going to be interesting to see what they come out with.
The question for you, Pete, is I looked at the weaponry which Enemy purchased on that second round and now the third round. You can see actually relics there. Of course, Skylar is his first name. He's done the old school switcheroo, got it back to front, but he has a Galil in hand. It's always a weapon that I find I'm never really happy with when I'm on a T-site, because really, it's not the best when you move on to gun rounds. You'd much prefer an AK, and it's a really heavy investment if you're just talking about using it for those anti-eco rounds. Of course, it costs a lot. You're not getting that SMG bonus. It's a weapon that I think would have slowly started to be phased out over the course of CSGO.
Yeah, certainly with the strength of SMGs, that Galil has less and less relevancy, it seems, day by day. But however, in saying that, if he's prepared to keep it for the gun round, it's not necessarily the most unwise investment, as the nade comes over and just crushes one of these YCG players in A, and Uber will make his way up the A ramp, picking up one and two frags. So a nice, round here, following the script pretty much entirely here for Enemy, as Chocolate gets himself started with that Tech Knight. Of course, Cooster is his name, and AWP will be his gun of choice for this match today. And it's just unfolding really, really standard here for Enemy GG as Davey picks up a single kill. But it'll be interesting to see how he uses that AWP next round. He's only got a Tech Knight at the moment, so he will definitely be buying that AWP for Chocolate, aka Cooster. And it'll be interesting to see where he uses it.
Davey, though, proving a menace on his anti-eco rounds. Again, he's picked up himself a nice little double there, a nice two-piece feed. He actually picks up the AK as well and tries to retreat to save that, because, I mean, that's a lot of money which he won't have to invest next round if he can. And he can be guaranteed that NLWB actually wants to get that out of his hands. But, of course, the sacrifice they make is, if they're not successful, is, ooh, lucky there, gets a tag on. Can't quite finish the job, though. If they're not successful, you could see Enemy forced to rebuy more weaponry, but as it is, Lucky does spot Davey moving into the checkers area. So his position is now known, but I might just say, Pete, as well, I like those headshots we saw from Uber there. I mean, Canadian player has a reputation for being the entry fighter in his team, so certainly Enemy will be wanting, as we do see Davey get taken down, Enemy will be wanting more out of Uber and more frags like that as the match progresses.
Yeah, similar to, I like the basketball analogy quite a lot. If your star player gets going early, it's always good. But if one of the role players gets going early, it's even better. So as the entry fragger gets going here, 5-1 to start the game, it's really good signs here for Enemy GG as they look to defend the push here. Nothing too serious. We see Chocolate does have that AWP up, aka Cooster. So he will go to work and he will just find his way back towards mid after, I think, just getting a cheeky shot off there at A ramp. And he's slowly going to make his way back towards mid and B. But Splice GG not really biting on anything here at the moment. They're just content to sit around and watch the grenades come in and play a very reactive style.
But they've done a great job here by showing that early aggression in mid. It's really, really slowed Enemy down to the extent there's 1:05 left on the clock and they haven't even gained mid control. They're throwing a lot of utility grenades at the moment, trying to gain mid. Of course, Lucky here scouting out B, but it's wasted almost 45 seconds off the clock in which Enemy can't actively say they've actually achieved anything.
Yeah, but they haven't achieved anything towards the bomb sites just yet, but Splice GG are pretty certain they're going to move towards A. And they've left mid completely unattended, which I'm not a huge fan of. You need to at least have some mid control, as Professor Chaos has actually got that AWP, as we suspected. It's not on Arya, so he's going to match up against Cooster this round. But at the moment, he's just happy scouting mid from the A bomb side. And now it's really danger signs for Enemy GG, as there's now 30 seconds left on the clock and nothing really going on at all. But the raid's going to come in here because of the position on A ramp and mid con, that A is going to be the bomb side of choice for them, as they're going to going to make their way into that site. Now the rotation call will come in from Splice. So the B players are on their way, but Lucky opens it up nicely there with a shot onto A1. Arya trades well, and he goes down. But Professor Chaos is there providing that defense as Junior Nasty, aka Jason Art, picks one up as well. So now all of a sudden, Koos is left in a 3-1, and he gets timed out with that AWP. A great showing of defense there by Splice, and not choking at all.
I've got my arms in the air at the moment, if I'm honest, because I'm just not sure what enemy were trying to achieve that round. I mean, we saw Splice throw a few smoke grenades and flashes up middle at the start. They actually had three members concentrated there, just trying to stop any aggression from enemy. But for the expense and expenditure of perhaps maybe $1,000 worth of grenades, they probably got about $10,000 worth of value, because enemy essentially just ran out of time completely in the end. We saw them running towards the A site with about 20 seconds left, but we just accused them missed that shot there. But really, nothing happening from enemy last round. I like the fact now that they're showing a little bit more intent and purpose. They have lost one member, though. Their key star player in the form of Chocolate, aka Kooster, has gone down here.
Yeah, and A1 will also pick up a kill on Relics in A Carpet. So the round not going as planned for enemy. Kooster holding onto that AWP, but Professor Chaos pushing out short there and nailing him. Mainline just taking down Arya there. So Arya, I should say. But for me, I think that last round, enemy really expected the a push from Splice, and they didn't get it. So a good mix-up of pace here. Jason R patiently holding this side, and Ubers pick up that AWP with every intention of probably giving it back to Kooster when the next round comes in. But once again, at the moment, we see enemy GG just stalling for time and taking a long while to make the decision of where they're going to hit at the moment, just casually tuning into mid.
Look at the information, though, that Davey's actually got. He's actually pushed through the B halls to underpass. So whilst we now see enemy walking short to B, they're going to find themselves in an empty site. Davey will be communicating, oh, B's clear, mid's clear, be prepared for an A attack. Well, Davey, go back to where you were because they're coming your way.
Definitely a slow and methodical approach taking this round, as once again, there's no sound being made, but only 25 seconds left to get this bomb down. And luckily for enemy, they're going to be able to get into the site that's been completely given to them, as you said, by the push. So the rotation's going to come in, but decent after plant spots here for the enemy GG players. It won't happen for them. Professor Chaos hitting a very nice AWP shot there onto Uber, and the AWP goes down. Davey with the flank back through carpet, but Mainline's going to be the one to try and force the action. He'll go down as well. Beautiful patience there shown by Splice, but giving enemy the plant there was a little bit weird.
A little bit weird, but I must say the play of the round for me was the fact that Davey, recognizing that there was nothing in B horse and nothing in mid as he pushed through underpass, made the great decision to backtrack where he came from. A lot of players, I think you'd find in that instance, would perhaps push mid to help fortify the A defense, expecting a palace attack or a T-ramp attack, maybe some set smokes coming in from the T's, but made the right read to backtrack towards the B site. And in the end, that presence that he had in palace, I mean, I think you only got one frag in the end as it was, but it meant that the T's were so confined and almost suffocating under the pressure that the CT's were applying on that retake.
Yeah, and as I said, I do like Splice's Mirage, because they were able to take down Optic just a week or so ago on this map. So there's definitely something there for Splice, as they fall behind on the scoreboard 3-2, but now obviously enemy onto an eco round, so this could unfold here nicely. Davey's got an opportunity to go massive here. You see all the enemy players lined up in carpet, and that grenade will only really touch Kooster as all the enemy GG players are ready to go. Davey's on here to go absolutely ham. He doesn't even get one. The aim wasn't too good there. Professor Chaos luckily cleans up the entry frag there for his team. And Mainline looking at backs now and should pick up a kill here on A1 if he's lucky. He does take him down. So a gun able to get up in a good position here for enemy. And all to do here for Splice to try and retake and save this round.
Yeah, you can see, I'm in a 4-on-3 situation. Great use of the Molotovs there by enemy, really, to slow down this retake. Arya, though, moving to the side, only has one point of health and is going for the man fuse. The 10-second defuse, of course, not to work out for him in that instance, but all of a sudden, Professor Chaos with the AWP has no choice but to save his gun. Something really interesting for me is that two things. One, that's actually the first round in which we've seen enemy with any real intent on committing to a bombsite. They went straight to B. There was no sort of toing and froing. Once the call was made, they executed onto the site, and you can see how much better it turned out for them in the sense that they made those great entry and trade frags and really set themselves up well. But also the fact, as we see Kooster here trying to find Professor Chaos, but not to be, also the fact that the T's actually purchased, whilst they had Tech9 and Armor, four of them bought Molotovs. That's extremely rare on an eco round to invest so heavily. But once they were in the site, they were so gold in the terms of being able to lock out that rotation and buy themselves that extra time. So I love that decision.
Yeah, I'm not too sure that had everything to do with the skill of the entry frag more than the failure of Davey to connect on anyone, as we see Lucky with the transfer spray there from one target to another. Brilliant piece of recoil control there, as it looks as though enemy are going to run over this A bomb site and get into fragging mode, as mainline also takes down Junior Jason R. So this is going to be very tricky here for Aria and Davey to even get back into A. The enemy lineup being very patient here, and we'll just wait for these kills to come in. They have spotted one in the jungle region, just beside the window room, and Aria will try and push into that smoke before being flashed out, and Davey left just with that mag 7, not being able to really do much, getting taken down, and that'll be the round.
I hope they recognize from an enemy perspective what's working here for them, because really they've had two gun rounds where they have just been holding back, very passive. They've been trying to, I think, position Cooster with that AWP tip, that opening frag, and haven't had as much success when they've been split out, leaving to that mid to late round situation to try and win. The rounds in which they're winning are where they're establishing themselves, they're committing quite heavily, be that the pistol round, or even the anti-ecos, or that B attack, where they're going very fast, getting in the faces of Splice, and I think the superior aim is winning out at the moment. You can see Splice again on an eco round, and I like the aggression here from enemy, that even though perhaps a lot of teams might be scared of the strength of pistols, enemy are just getting into those sites. They're sending in their entry frag, Uber in first, of course, but his support teammates are there to make sure that if he goes down, they will make the frag. And really, these rounds are looking so easy for enemy that it's a surprise to think back about the difficulty which they had on some of those previous gun rounds.
I think that they've just figured out the magical formula for today against Splice, which is going to be hyper-aggression. They're just going to get out of spawn nice and quick, commit to the one bomb site. It doesn't look as though the fakes really worked because of how defensive Splice were playing in that particular time early on. So they've switched up their gameplay, and we'll see Splice come away with another eco here. So they're going to try and get those AWPs back in hand for Professor Chaos and Aria to do their work maybe next round. But for the moment, they're going to be on another eco, and we should see enemy just, I guess, once again, roll pretty aggressively into A.
Yeah, but notice the difference as well. Even though they are split up at the moment on the enemy side, they're putting pressure on mid this time. There's Molotovs flowing left, right, and center. There's HE grenades. There's flashes. So it's really asserting their dominance in mid. It's forcing Splice back into the bomb sites. Of course, the rotation time between A and B is so large then if you're forced to hold within the sites. And really, even if they're not committing and rushing onto a site, they're doing a much better job this time of still having their way and asserting their dominance over Team Splice. You can see the frags going their way to back up what was a good opening start to the round for them, though Aria with a nice little shot there.
Yeah, and the AWP shot comes in there from Kusa, so that's a little gimme shot for him. A player on eco at pretty long distance, getting that AWP to connect. Hopefully that gets him going as we see him line up a second one. Not able to connect there, but rest assured he fixes that error pretty quickly and takes down A1, who's just trying
Abe, to... I think.
Abe?
Yep.
Abe, but for the purpose of this game, you'll refer to him as A1.
Well, that's right. It's his own fault, isn't it, for not tagging up properly?
For tagging up. That's right. But that's, definitely, yeah. Definitely, we see here, look, A1, okay, Abe has a Dak-Dak, or auto sniper, with Aria picking up that AWP2. So clearly, Splice think the success here is more reliant on their defensive capabilities and not being too aggressive and waiting for our enemy GG to make their move. But I think that they've made a little bit of a misread there, because I think enemy GG's success really lies in their aggressive play. So having that those two snipers can really limit how flexible you are on CT and the sort of reads and the speed at which you're able to move around the map.
Well, that's right. Certainly the purchase of two sniper rifles, because Abe has that Dak-Dak, but also I believe Aria had purchased an AWP, dropped it now in spawn with the pools coming. I think for perhaps Professor Chaos, they might do a gun swap there, but two sniper rifles. I mean, they only need to look back to that first gun round where three of them went towards mid, threw a few flashes and smokes and showed their presence, despite not taking any jewels, showed their presence, and it really stopped enemy in their tracks for almost a minute and a half. It was insane in that regard, but having two sniper rifles, it doesn't sort of lend itself to that same sort of strategy there, which is exactly what you speak of, so I agree with you. But really as well for me, questionable in terms of purchasing two sniper rifles off the back of having to really eco two to three rounds, if you include that really half force buy sort of situation in which they're in. And if they lose this, they've just spent all their money that they saved two rounds for, and they'll be back on ecoing ways again.
Yeah, and something I really don't like for Splice is the fact that Kusta is 9-2, and he hasn't had a single round where it's been impact at all So in 9 rounds of CS, he's accumulated 9 kills and 2 assists, and he's done absolutely nothing special whatsoever. So that spells danger, because if they actually run at him and he's got the opportunity to go huge, he's now set up and hit enough shots that he's going to be comfortable and confident, and they've already got a 7-2 lead. So I guess Splice here are really going to have their work cut out for them, and they're going to have to make the CT side work for them a little bit more.
That's right. I mean, you look at Splice at the moment, it's not just the team that's struggling. There's a few players as well across the board. I think they're really lacking the confidence in the frags to back it up on the scoreboard at the moment. Poor old A1, or Abe, as he's otherwise known. Of course, the Rifleman, previously played in Mythic in late 2014. He's struggling at the moment with one frag, so he needs to fire up. Aria, we spoke of the difficulties that he might have with a lot of responsibility as the captain, the in-game leader, probably the most accomplished player in the team. So hopefully for those guys, they can get firing quite quickly, because 7-2 down on CT side of Mirage is definitely going to be an uphill battle from here. You can see the players running out of spawn. I like this from Enemy. Again, very fast-paced in the sense that they've got Kusta very quickly towards these B-halls, looking for these early frags. This is much better from them.
Yeah, and I love the fact that Lucky on the T side of things has seen how they've held B a number of times, and he said to Kusta, I think your money's on here for just being able to go into B and get a pick. But for the first time, Arya is going to play that truck position with an AWP. Oh, I thought that second one was...
It was on him.
Was definitely close to his vicinity, or we might get some CSGO Rego there. But Arya picking up the double eventually on Lucky. Not, I guess, an ideal outcome for Enemy, but we liked where they were at. They just a B push that didn't work out for them, and now they're going to have to make this 2 versus 5 player clutch work for them.
Yeah, to be honest, I've got no problem with the way in which Enemy approached that round. I mean, obviously very risky, but from what Enemy had been showing and recognising what had been working for them and being that sort of hyper-aggressive going for the early picks in previous rounds, I'm not going to fault them in this round. I think that perhaps a little bit too bold in that sort of instance from perhaps Kusta as he walked out into B platform, really showing his dome to Arya there at the truck without too much resistance. But good positioning from mainline. We'll capture Arya off guard, but the bomb here left top of mid. So whilst he is getting a couple of frags, making this quite interesting, one of his teammates in the form of Ubo is going to have to backtrack all the way back to spawn nearly, recover that bomb, and then bring it to one of the bomb sites. So they'll be struggling to hit the bomb planted here, Pete, in a 2-on-3 situation.
Yeah, they're going to struggle to get it down, but I really like how mainline took his time there and gets both of those A kills going, so it's not going to work out in the end here with 16 seconds to go. He's going to have to do something absolutely crazy. Uber gets one, but immediately Professor Chaos there to shut him down.
But look at the surviving members there as well. Both of those sniper rifles, which we spoke of, the Dak Dak and the AWP, are gone. So those three frags in the last, 30 seconds of the round, 2 from mainline, I think 1 from Uber as well. That's worth its weight in gold in the sense that you can now see them struggling to purchase on the CT side. Abe or A1 has to make do with the FAMAS here. Professor Chaos can afford an AWP. But all of a sudden, that massive investment's come back to backfire for Splice.
Yeah, now all of a sudden, their money is not so good. If they lose this round, they're in horrible position. And you can see, even after losing that last round, how strong the economy for Enemy GG is. And they've gone away from that B and mid sort of hit, and they're going to be prepared to launch out A. But a brilliantly aggressive position here from Kusta and Carpets, getting that early spot on jungle. So Arya's just going to jump through that smoke and try and make something happen. And A1 on underneath the balcony there picks up a Famous double. And Arya jumping up the balcony and taking down Kusta. So a good round here unfolding, but it's still a 2 versus 2 situation. And Arya needs to be able to hold on to this A bomb site as he manages to get the spray down eventually. Headshot onto Lucky 1G, and that kill should just about do it for the T's. And indeed, Davey able to take down Uber.
Great 2v2. You have to feel for Lucky in that instance, though, because from his perspective, he was in mid-connector. He knew there was a member in jungle which he wanted to take a fight with. And when he looked towards the site before he was taken down, he saw a smoke there. So he thought he at least had some cover to be able to take that duel with the player in jungle. But the smoke actually dissipated as he started to fight. So good old Arya stepped around the flame box there and quite easily took him down from the side. But good win from Splice. We spoke about how they were in a tough situation which they must win to keep that momentum going. And they did just that.
Yeah, and they're going towards B, but Arya's managed to push himself unders and take down that bomb. So all the surprises gone out the window there for Arya, as unfortunately he decides to smoke instead of just keeping his gun out there. I thought he was on for a second one, and he needs to be really careful because some nades and some spray should come through the tunnel. But Davey also onto mainline before Lucky and Chocolate Kusta are able to pick up one apiece, and the headshot there through the box. Good pre-fire there from Professor Chaos taking down Kusta, but will it be enough? As now Uber picks up a double as well mid-round. Not really sure why the Splice guys were so aggressive there on the window after that brilliant pick by Professor Chaos, but now the Enemy GG guys will find their way into B. No, they won't. They'll fake that with a Molotov and run that bomb all the way back to A. So the correct read coming in here.
The key thing though, Uber there, the man you spoke of, actually threw some Molotovs and smokes into the site. Now, Professor Chaos was headed back to A, but he went to check back checkers and saw that smoke and it kept his attention for that time. You can see the bomb has now been planted. He still thinks it's B off the back of that smoke that he saw towards the van area. So he is scouting out the B site at the moment, completely unknowingly, the fact that the bomb is at A at the moment. So look at this precious time being ticking away. And as he realizes, which I think reality is now setting in that the bomb is at A, too much time has now passed, and this will be a round going enemy's way. Fantastic use of Molotov and smoke grenades there by Uber. It won his team that round single-handedly. I mean, obviously a 2-on-1, you'd normally bank on your team winning it anyway, but those two utility grenades really sealed the deal. Great work.
Yeah, and I guess for me, those two quick-fire headshots as well really turn the tide. If the trading is not great on CT and one T player is able to get a double kill, those rounds will go into your favor as T a lot of the time, because once those two players holding that side of the map go down in a very quick succession, the rotations are almost impossible to gauge when and where it's going to happen. So Uber doing really good work for his team there. And now enemy GG are up 8-4, and all eyes will be on Professor Chaos this round as he's got the AWP for Team Squads.
He does. He actually took it towards the B side, but a nice fray there from Mario. I think that's the second time we've praised his D to work. He gets one, goes for the second, but lucky there in underpass, does step out and makes that trade kill. But I was just going to say, Professor Chaos here, all alone in B, all on his lonesome at the moment, whilst you can see enemy making the way towards A. So perhaps making the correct read. I don't think they've had too much information to suggest that he'll be at B, other than the fact that that's where he's tended to hide out in previous rounds. But it's important that they really commit to this site now, before he can get there, Professor Chaos that is, to back up his teammates.
Yeah, and Relic's doing a great job there, taking down Abe at the A ramp, and Lucky will pick up one as well. Davey picks up a double, so it could be turning back towards the way of Splice, but as quickly as it was turning back, there he is. There's Koos with AWP, and making his presence felt in that round. And once again, he's on 12 kills, 2 assists and 5 deaths without ever really having done anything particularly special.
That's the biggest thing for me. You say that, and it sounds, people might be saying, what are you talking about? He's got 12 frags. How could he not have done anything special? But you're exactly right. That's the way it feels. He hasn't had any magical 1 versus 3, 1 versus 4 sort of scenarios. He's just been making it work. We can see Splice. I mean, they forced the issue here. Professor Chaos does take that all towards Mikon, does get a nice tag onto Kusta. So whilst he doesn't drop it, Kusta is down to 19 HP. Chocolate, his sweet of choice, I must take that to be. But at the moment, you can see enemy really forced to back off. We saw this on the first gun run where Splice showed that aggression, and it was enemy that really stalled for time there afterwards, and seeing the same thing again. We can see a few members committing to the A side at the moment. Uber and Relics both go down though. Nice flashes there by Abe, really stopping that fake in its tracks as the bomb now makes its way towards B, and the fake not as successful when you've already lost two members there. And I've actually lost the Procaster as well, because PDG has gone for an emergency toilet break. So we can see at the moment, as he is back, we can see the bomb has now been planted. It's a 2-on-3 situation, 4-team enemy here. You can see Mainline is quite low, so a lot of pressure here on Lucky's shoulders. His position on the side, Ari there does spot out Mainline, does take him down, so a nice opening frag there in this retake. But, oh, look at the use of the smokes there. Lucky actually swindling his way through to catch Ari off guard, but Abe up to the challenge, and great work there by Splice. I love the way in particular Abe shut down that A fake before it really eventuated and meant that they found themselves in a 5-on-3 retake scenario.
Yeah, it's as I've alluded to a few times, I think it's a real troublesome start to this game, given that Kusta's just cruising, not really doing anything, because CT is really where he's going to be of the most value to this team on Mirage, getting in that window, being the aggressor, taking that initiative, and this game really hinges on Splice GG able to make something happen in the last round of the half, getting that 9-6, and obviously the mental hurdle of getting to that 10 rounds, the double digits, is going to be big for them. So 9-6 is going to be a much better result for Splice here as they slowly work over the map. Aria picking up a great kill there on Lucky, and Uber will pick up Junior as well. A1 as well picking up a kill. This is to and froing all over the map, every choke point being fought for at the moment. And now Splice has got a 3-on-2, but two AWPs and an auto shotgun, so not that much versatility here. for Enemy to have to really fight off.
That's right, and Davey actually spots on it from the ticker box there. Actually switches away from the shotgun given the range that you spoke of, and in the end, had to use his P2K. Does a little bit of damage but can't get the frag, but more importantly, his presence is known. It's a good thing in the sense that Splice currently have the flank going here with Arya, and it's probably going to take the attention away from Arya if Davey can at least shoot at a couple of enemies, and he does just that. You can see they're actually positioned well. The triangle effect has really come in here. You can see one at mid-con, one at ticker box, and one at T-main as well, so poor old Enemy have a lot of directions to cover. You can see mainline. He is holding the bomb at the moment. So whilst he's positioned in Palace, we'll need to try and get into that site. But Arya here will prove to be the death of Relics. The ex-Method Man does fall. It's all left up to the captain and in-game leader here in mainline.
Yeah, and it's going to be a pretty uphill battle here for mainline. The term unwinnable is thrown around a lot, but with 22 seconds to go and no real entry frag on offer here, but he does pick up Arya, who I don't know why he was picking that so aggressively with the Deagle when he had a sniper, but shouldn't really cost his team anything. It's the last round of the half, and
do it, Davey.
Mainline's gonna struggle. Yes. There. Davey jumps off the crate and takes down mainline with a nice headshot there. So 9-6 going the way of Enemy. A good start to them. Good start to the game for them, I should say, in this two map series as they go up 9-6 in the first half of the first map and transfer across to this CT side. And it's really going to be about what Splice can do in terms of getting Professor Chaos to be nice and aggressive, I think, and getting those entry kills, as we definitely saw Uber doing that for the Enemy guys.
Yeah, I think the difficulties moving to the gun round will be the fact that Kooster is self-proclaimed a much more aggressive player on CT side, and that can be very, very dangerous and deadly, particularly on CT side Mirage. We can see them heading towards the B side here, though, so perhaps an execute in mind.
Yeah, it's going to be a full-on B attack here for the Splice guys, as we saw an all-off A attack from Enemy, but they're going to be pretty well prepared for this. Two members still in B. They've spotted out now. They will hear the footsteps, and it's going to be on the Enemy GG players to try and defend this bomb site. Mainline doing a great job picking up one there, but not dying. So that's great work from the in-game leader, getting a double. Mainline and Lucky will go down before Kooster makes his way in. Picks up a double. Can he get the triple? No. Davey able to reply, and now it's a 2v1, and Davey's binked one of the two players. So can he find one of these kills and turn the round on its head? The bomb will go down, and a very safe plan. I think he knows where both of them are. So Davey here with a great opportunity to put Splice back into this game with a great display of pistol accuracy as he gets Uber, and it's going to be on the last player for Enemy GG to try and get this one done. He does have a kid. Can he find the headshot? He does. So the diffuser will come in, and it's unfortunate end for a great round there by Splice.
Absolutely superhuman effort, though, you have to say, for mainline there. I mean, he was the player that boosted Lucky onto the books in the site, clearly set up to be a distraction so that he would take the attention away from Lucky in the site, but got two frags, but more importantly, survived what felt like a lifetime there for about 30 seconds or somewhat in B, with all five terrorists raining down upon him. I mean, I have no idea how he survived that long, but it bought time for that rotation from his teammates, and Kooster capitalized on the back of that survival technique, Bear Grylls style, getting two frags and setting up that retake.
Yeah, and similarly to when we saw Enemy win the T-Pistol, when they won the CT-Pistol, they opted for those three rifles, two SMG setup, so a consistent approach to their gameplay being taken on both sides. You see Kooster there with the M4, just being hyper-aggressive, already checking out mid by himself, but it's going to be an A hit here for Splice, so Enemy will be on the back foot here trying to defend, but the smokes and the flashes aren't going to be very effective as the Enemy GG players jump all over this A site, and should be a pretty simple out from here on in.
Well, that's right. It's all down to two members. Davey actually has a Galil in hand. I know we talked about Force Buys. Well, this is the extreme Force Buy when on the second round you have a Galil. He has been really left to his own devices there in the site. There, he has got two frags. He's lost his teammate, though, so he had it all to do. Can't quite convert there, but whilst they got close in that sort of situation, it's a no-win for Splice because now they're in that awful predicament where they know that they've come close on the previous Force Buy. They've done a lot of economic damage to Enemy, and you'd be so tempted to buy again, because you know that if you could win that next round, you'd break the bank of Enemy. But by the same token, if you were to buy, it'd be again another really compromised quasi-buy situation with just pistols. And I mean, the chances of success are quite low in that instance. So it's always that mental predicament.
Yeah, and I think that generally speaking, if you're a terrorist side and you get the bomb down on pistol, there shouldn't really be any force buying second rounders. Once again, Kooster plays super aggressive on mid, gets one and gets taken down. But his teammates should be alerted to the danger as Abe takes the full force of an HE grenade that comes out of short, so mainline there with a great grenade to set up a lot of damage, and Uber will spot a number of different players coming through mid, so the call will come out, but he's all trapped by himself, and he should go down here. Great work by Davey picking up a double, and just as we were confident about enemy holding on to this eco round, we were sort of blasé about it at the start. All of a sudden, Splice have made this work, and 4 versus 2 situation here for mainline and Lucky.
Well, they made it work with much less equipment and utility than they actually had in the previous round, so there goes that analysis. But you can see enemy actually intent on going for this retake, and they've taken down 2 members. All of a sudden, Lucky finds himself in a 1-on-2, does drop one there, so has to take down Abe. That's the last surviving member, and crucially, he knows the position now as Abe does fire a few shots, charges in with only 21 points of health. Actually so intent on taking that jewel, and in the end, does go down, and with the kid in hand, there is enough time for that bomb defuse to come on in, and I've got no idea why Abe was so blasé in that retake, or trying to defend that retake attempt there, throwing away his life, and really the round there for his team.
Yeah, that was absolutely crazy. First of all, I was going to really rip on Kusa there for jumping out the window with an M4 and losing his rifle, because Davey picked up that M4 and got 2 kills, and then all of a sudden Splice just running away from the bomb, thinking enemy was saving. They all go down and lose the round, and if you're the in-game leader, Aria, for Splice, it's either a bad read from you and you've told your team to push you, or you're pretty disappointed with how that one ended up working out. So no one will know who's responsible for that from a Splice perspective. All we know is that it didn't end up going too well for them. Maybe a result of that 40-second new addition from Valve and that increased bomb time effect, but who will know there as Relix picks up the opening frag for the round.
Does a good job there, doesn't it? But as mainline goes down, really that opening exchange is quite meaningless in the sense that the T's are now equal the ledger, and certainly it makes it a lot tougher for the CTs to try and hold off both bomb sites. You can see at the moment their defense is quite stretched, but Uber from long range at the ticker box actually drops one, and Kusner capitalizes on the fact that the T's momentarily, their attention was diverted towards the A site where Uber had got that frag and steps out from window and gets himself a nice double, and really, Uber set up those 2 frags for Kusner.
Yeah, definitely. The real problem for me is both teams have been super successful in all rounds. CTNT, when they've been the aggressor and they've gone for the aggro picks and got control of the round early and then just basically run over a bombsite. The longer the rounds go on, they seem to favor enemy GG every time. Aside from that 1 or 2 rounds we saw at the start where enemy GG were caught off guard by aggression as Davey picks up Relix, I think it's all been one-sided after the round goes more than about a minute for the enemy GG boys.
Well, that's the thing. I mean, you look at the streak of rounds on the scoreboard here. Poor old Splice. They've had a hard time, haven't they, in which they've only been able to, in little short stints, string together 2 rounds at a time. Nothing more than that. And obviously, not just the implications on the money, but also on the confidence, the morale of the team as they find themselves on further eco rounds. It makes it tough to really establish any sort of momentum, doesn't it? You can see now they have force board again. 13-6, they can't afford to let enemy get any more rounds on the board at this stage, but it means that they'll have 3 AKs and 2 Tech-9s in hand at the moment. Quite a few utility grenades as well, so Pete, they'll make their way towards B here, trying to make something of it.
Yeah, but enemy GG are going to be all too aware of this one, but Lucky in a pretty poor position there, going to be taken down by Abe almost immediately, and now Professor Chaos will make his way in and take down mainline as well, so let us not jump to conclusions that this one's over just yet, but geez, you'd be disappointed if you were Splice and you didn't come away with this win now as a 5 versus 3 unfolds for Splice to defend.
Yeah, you can see at the moment, I think enemy, the mission is to try and keep Splice locked into the bombsite. Key man for me, you could see Relix there. I mean, he had no intent of pushing those B-Halls, but actually using his smoke and HE grenades to really let his presence be known in the end does get taken down. But I think that'll force perhaps Kusta to try and fall back. He was doing that before Aria pounces on him and takes him down. So good round here by Splice, but again, it's that early intent that you speak of, Pete. That's what won them that round, is they committed to the B site. There was no mucking around in mid or splitting up the forces. They committed to B very early on. Whilst sometimes that isn't the best approach, certainly in this matchup and what we're seeing tonight, it's certainly working well for the team that is having that early aggression and committing themselves to a bomb site there. They won those duels. Lucky caught out of position there. Not so lucky, but good work there by Splice.
Yeah, definitely. And someone we've mentioned often in our casts of Splice has been this Jason R player, and he's certainly struggling today, but I think he's a key for Splice. If he can get going and really display that aim, as Professor Chaos will strafe frag 2 players in mid, Uber and Chocolate going down there with Relix not far behind, Aria picking up one. Now Lucky running through that mid smoke. Professor Chaos will end up with a triple this round, and Jason R will probably find a kill here, and he does. if he gets going, if Jason R can come to the party at this point, he's only on 6 kills, but it's not a lost cause yet.
Yeah, and it's interesting, you talked about Jason R as well, because he's obviously a rising talent in the Canadian CSGO scene, but his actual role, from what we understand, is he's the actual entry fragger. And if your entry fragger is the one struggling for kills, it's never a good way to really open up these rounds, is it? Because all of a sudden, you'd mostly find yourselves coming off the back of a deficit or struggling to open up those sites. So I think that's one of the reasons why, when the team are grouping up and really committing as one, that they're having much more success than perhaps relying on their entry fragger to be opening up these slots in that slower pace style.
Yeah, and as I said, sort of during the knife round, we aren't actually sure if Enemy GG or Splice are CT or T teams in this instance. So smokes and flashes will come over A, and Splice will commit to this A bomb site. They're heavily out resourcing their teammates. And Uber, who was the lone rifler with the scout there, gets taken out by Jason R. And that man, if he gets going, this could really set off the Splice roster, as he'll pick up a second kill this round. So with every kill, I feel as though Splice, for Jason R that is, I feel as though Splice are one step closer to getting back into gear.
Look at this though, the bomb's making its way towards B. If we look at the overlay, Relics is actually right behind the bomber right now. I think, unfortunately for him, he was probably about 3 to 4 seconds off with his timing, but he would have almost had clear vision there of the fact that the bomb was going to be. Ultimately, it's not going to matter. I mean, he does get the frag now, but 4-on-1 sort of situation, they will take him down quite easily. Jason R, the man who opened up the round, will also finish it off as he does get that final frag there into the B apartments. And all of a sudden, whilst we've seen Enemy having their way for most of this match, the scoreline, it's very close again, isn't it? 13-9. Enemy, though, of course, will be able to afford and buy everything that they'd hope for and more into this round.
Yeah, and for the first time in the game, we've seen Splice GG string together 3 consecutive round wins, so signs are good for them. Signs of life, of course, from Jason R, as he picked up a triple in that last round, and now the Enemy GG economy is on full tilt as they've completely invested in this round. Obviously, if they lose, they're going to be facing a double eco. So this game is hanging in the balance at the moment. And Splice being nice and aggressive in mid, although Relics will be there to defend this A split by the looks of things, as they're pretty content on holding mid. But the emphasis on the rotator is going to be on A, as they pick up the bomb. So complete indecision shown here. They're pretty happy to just get Aria into that mid-con, but Relic seems to be aware that there's something going on. Not exactly sure how close, but he's been picked off from that spot a couple of times already. Splice GG making their way back to A, and unfortunately, I don't love this pace. We've said how good they've been when they've been aggressive, and they've taken such a slow approach this round, and now it should be pretty easy for Enemy to get the jump on them as they try and hit this A bomb site.
That's right, the smokes and flashes, they've come over the top now, and all 4 surviving members of Splice will now execute. 1 through Palace, you can see Davey coming out there. Does get the drop though onto Relic, so all of a sudden, they find themselves with an opening into this bomb site. Uber though, quick to shut that down. He does drop down Davey, and all of a sudden, mainline off the back of some nice team flashes, falls into Sandwich, gets a nice double, can he get a triple? Is blinded by, I think, one of his teammates, unfortunately, but in the end, he does get the job done. Great work there by Mainline. But I might just say, I mean, the intent there from Splice, I actually liked. I mean, going for an A attack there with one member in mid-con, I mean, always so dangerous. It can be great positioning for Aria potentially to step out. But the way in which they got that player into mid-con by having their whole team go to mid, use all those utility grenades to set him up, but then fall back around through T-spawn, the timing is just too long. There's no way that he can be expected to survive, especially with all the mid-presence that they showed earlier suggesting he might be there. He then needs to survive for 30 seconds on his own. That's never going to work. I think if it was perhaps a split attack getting him in at the same time, as we threw Z Cooster there with 2 early frags to finish off that point, might have had more success for Pete.
Yeah, and we talk about getting the job done in terms of fragging. Mainline 20 kills, Uber 19 kills, Lucky 1G 17 kills, and Coost on 21 kills. So only Relic struggling, but when you've got 4 players going, as we see here for Enemy, it's going to be a tough ask for the Splice guys, as Shotgun picks up his 3rd, aka Cooster will get the no-scope. So in a clutch round here, he's picked up 4 kills, and all he needs to do is try and find that 5th kill for the AWP team down, but it looks as though Relics will spot him out and get that headshot. So great round, impact round there. It's 15-9, and it's the first time we've seen Cooster do anything.
Yeah, I like how you just casually dropped in the cast that all he needs to do is just find that 5th kill, as though it's just some simple task for the man. But given what we've seen in recent performances, it would seem to be that simple. I mean, that's the first time in which he's really come alive this match, and yet he's still at the top of the scoreboard. 23 frags in only what is, 24 rounds? So nearly that 1 KPR at the moment, and his team now find themselves with 6 match points here. You can see Splice seemingly just resorting to what looks to be a set AX. You can see a couple of the members of the team already positioned, Professor Chaos here with the smoking hand, which will go towards the stairs. And now, Pete, they will execute. Their match hopes rest in their ability to take the A side here.
And Davey could play a huge role in what goes on because he's at mid, just biding his time. Jason R trying to find his way out of carpet. Will he get one? He does through the smoke. Relics goes down, so good opening there for Splices. Professor Chaos also takes that Uber. But importantly, here comes Cooster as he picks up the first one. He's in great position to get multi-frags here, but Abe will find one in mid-con and will take down. We'll take down Cooster, so now it's a 3v1. Mainline has been spotted out as well, so it's going to be tough for him to win this round. He doesn't. Jason R gets a Molotov, and once again, we see the pace of that T side being rewarded here. The aggression coming out, that A hit coming straight off the bat, not delaying in mid any sort of resources or commitment, and that's working out for Splice. So only one more round to go here. If they could pick up this next round, Nick, then enemy will be on full financial meltdown once again.
Yeah, I'm surprised to see them actually force the issue here. You can see the enemy have full support. It means an Uber. Normally the entry fragile of the team actually has a scout in hand. So, I mean, they had plenty of rounds to play for, but clearly they want to get the job done now and move on to the next map, which will be trained. You can see Aria, I think, here, recognizing that there's a little bit too much mid-presence being shown by Team Enemy. I think his teammates would have been communicating that. He's made the call to commit to the A-site very early. This is what we like in terms of the pace, but now the execution, can they get it done here? They've got flashes and smokes laid down. It's helping them out at the moment in the sense that they've got a 2-for-1 exchange, and they will now be able to get that bomb down if Aria so chooses. The smoke well-positioned there to cover him from CT spawn, and really, Enemy find themselves on the back foot again here, Pete.
Yeah, but Cooster picking up an important frag there, and this is going to be on Lucky to try and get this mid-kill. Can he get it? He does. So now a 3v1 for Jason R to try and hold on to this round. He's got a minute, and he's got the bomb, and he knows where the first one is. So he takes down Chocolate. He also takes down Uber. So to keep his team in this game, he's going to have to pull a 3v1, a rabbit out of the hat, and can Jason R do it? He sees him. He spots him. He takes down Lucky. I guess the throw is sort of real for Enemy, but more so brilliant work there from Jason R, and signs of life for Splice as Enemy will now be forced to eco and try and stay in this game as Splice seem to take control of the economy for at least just a brief period.
Oh, I don't know why they were pushing him though, but some incredible shots in that 1-on-3. I mean, we spoke about his need to really fire up on the scoreboard earlier on in this half. Well, he's now got 15 fragged and he's right there with his teammates, but what could be more crucial than those last three to keep his team's chances alive? Enemy now forced to eco. They still have plenty of rounds to play with though. If I'm them, knowing that perhaps likely to lose this round with just some pistols in hand, I'm still not panicking. I mean, they still have potentially three rounds after the after this in which they can force the economy. I mean, worst case scenario is that they go to OT. I'm still very, very calm and collected in my shoes at the moment, but really this match should be done and dusted at the moment.
Yeah, but it should be, but unfortunately it's not, as Aria picks up Relics and they're going to make their way into the A bomb site. So this is pretty much a free go around here for Splice. None of the members for Enemy are remotely close, Davey. The double kill through the little gap. Mac-10 doing the work there, just spraying through a tiny little gap, and Junior Nasty, as I so affectionately call him, Jason R, will pick up mainline and just set this one up. It's a 5v1 for Cooster, the star of Enemy, but you know, unwinnable is a term I use a lot now, but I can safely put this in that category. Cooster will pick up one and try and save an AK, and he doesn't get away. Professor Chaos there quickly on the trade. And signs of life here for Splice. It's all about will Enemy force the round, and they do, Nick. So big decision here for Enemy, as they've got just on that 4K mark, not a whole lot of resource around for them. They've got smokes and flashes, but no kits. So this is all going to have to be about what they can do with the rifles here in this round.
You know, I'd like them to recognize the fact that Splice are now up in that tempo that we speak of, perhaps shoring down those bomb sites very early on, making sure that there's men in position should they execute. But mainline with this fantastic position here, he will catch Davey off guard. We've seen that position used once to effect already this match by Aria. Now it's mainline making his own. He actually picks up a second in mid and staying alive. And Pete, as the frags go all the way of Enemy at the moment, why not have a triple mainline? Can he get the fourth? This looks to be the first map going the way of Enemy, and that it is. 16-12, great job, but great aggression there in that final round, turning the table, and really, Enemy sealing the deal for what looked like their match for much of it.
Yeah, and I mean, it's really not side-specific. The aggression has been rewarded. So regardless of if they're playing on CT or on T-side, whoever was the aggressor and tried to take control of, I guess, the most effectively was rewarded by the round win. So nice closeout there for Enemy GG, an expected result. And as we move into train, they'll take a 1-0 lead. But not as convincing as you might have thought.
Yeah, I was just going to say that as well, because you look at the end scoreline, 16-12. I must admit, just from my experience watching that game and how it felt, which is obviously something that's quite intangible, but it never felt to me as though Splice were ever really in the match, as bad as that sounds, given that the score is 16-12. It always felt that Enemy were in the driver's seat. I mean, we saw them start off so strong on the T side after one or two very strange first gun rounds in which really they stood around doing not much at all. Once they had that intent and brought that aggression to their T side, they raced out to a 7-2 lead, and from there on, they were really in control, dictating the pace. You could see that Splice were struggling to string more than two rounds together. Even in the end, when Splice were able to mount a little bit of a resurgence and get back into it on the scoreboard-wise, I mean, Enemy, it was really just, to me, felt like a matter of time until they closed it out. And in the end, they made the frags, they brought that aggression onto that final gun round and did just that. Great showing by them, but the scoreline was a bit too generous to Splice for how the match felt to me.
I completely agree with that breakdown. And for me, I really like to see Jason Argot going in towards the back half of that T side for Splice. Obviously, Mirage wasn't their pick. It was Enemy GG. So as far as they're concerned, they've just taken care of business. Now it moves on to Train. And I talked at the start about Professor Chaos and his impact on these very open bomb sites on Train. Aside from the initial hit, if you can get yourself into these bomb sites with the smokes up, Train becomes almost like a lottery of who sees who first behind what angle. So that high sensitivity could be rewarded here for Professor Chaos. But Jason R, for me, if he got hot at the end of that last map, he could hold the key for Splice here if they're really to show any sort of strength on Train.
You're right. And the point that I'd make, this is irrespective of either team, is that I think Train, in my opinion, particularly that A bomb site, lends itself more to that early aggression. I think, like you're saying, the ability for the terrorists to create those lanes and block them off with smokes and get out into the bomb site and take those face-to-face duels is a more easier task, in my opinion, than perhaps asserting your aggression on a map like T-side Mirage, where running up T-ramp on A site can be difficult, or running towards that small choke point in B halls can be difficult. So I think I'd be expecting a map in which we see an even more fast-paced game, and a map which potentially is over even faster than Mirage was. And I think that regardless of which team is showing that aggression, I think that both teams find themselves in a position in which they'll be able to, should they choose it and recognize it, establish their authority and dominance over the other team.
Yeah, I think that with Mirage, it was always going to be hard for Splice because of how dynamic Kusta